Hi, everyone, and welcome back to Spotlight with Scientists in School. Joining me on the program today, we have Dr. Cylita Guy. Dr. Guy is a data scientist, an urban ecologist, a bat specialist, and most recently, a children's book author. Her first book, Chasing Bats and Tracking Rats, is due out in November, published by Annick Press. And today we're going to talk about her book. We're going to dispel some common bat myths. We're going to talk about why urban ecology is important. So let's not waste any time. Let's head on over and meet Dr. Guy. Hi, everyone, and welcome to Spotlight with Scientists in School. And I am so excited today. Joining me, I have Dr. Cylita Guy. Thanks for being here.
Well, thanks for having me.
I have wanted you on this show for a very long time, so I was so happy when I got the email. You do so many things, and they're all just so exciting. I think you're inspiring to the young and the old. Good stuff. So let's get started. When did your love of STEM begin?
Yeah, I find this question a tough one because there are days when I feel like I've always been in love with it, and there are days where I feel like that love is a little forced and maybe I've made it up. But I would say like a pretty young age, but with a lot of encouragement from my parents. So like growing up, we were taught to be curious and to explore. We were given lots of opportunity to explore, which I think is the key thing. And so as kids, I'm from the city of Toronto. We were at the science center almost every weekend. We were checking out different things, but we were also like tinkering with my dad in his garage. He's a mechanic. So like learning about that, going on walks at the park. I grew up very close to Bluffers Park. So we spent a lot of time in that green space. So always kind of just exploring. And so I think, you know, that's when I think of like where my love of STEM began. And I think that's really where it started, with those like very early moments of like being encouraged by the adults in my life to ask questions and to explore and kind of being given that free rein and exposure.
Yeah, I think you've touched on things like being curious, but having that encouragement, and also that the fact that you were outside a lot, like in nature, that's a common theme, right? Being outside.
Yeah. And I mean, I grew up to become an ecologist. I spent a lot of time outside and thinking about outside things, but I also, you know, equal parts spend time at a desk, at a computer, using things like data science and machine learning and artificial intelligence to answer questions. So it's interesting how that love of being outside turned me into a scientist who now does a lot of data analysis. I think it's kind of interesting how you can bounce around.
So let's dive into urban ecology. What would you, how would you describe what your job is really?
Yeah, so urban ecology or urban ecologists are people who study nature in cities. And so we spend a lot of time thinking about, you know, how the plants and animals that we share our urban environments with, how their behavior changes when they live in cities compared to their natural habitats. But we also spend time thinking about like what sorts of creatures are missing from our city landscapes, like who can't really adapt to city living. And we ask these kinds of questions because we're trying to understand, you know, how we can design cities better in the future. We know that having nature around is good. It makes us happier, healthier. Nature also delivers a lot of what we call ecosystem service. It adds a lot of value, right? Trees provide us with shade. They combat extreme heat events. You know, lots of insects pollinate, birds pollinate, bats pollinate, right? So we want to have nature present in cities. So we need to understand what it needs to survive and then design our cities to make space for it in a way that is good for both nature and humans alike.
So how do you feel when you see a parking lot coming up? Is that a bad thing?
Yeah, that I won't lie. Impervious, the parking lot, impervious surface, you know, surfaces water can't seep through. They make me sad. They significantly heat up our, right, you know, if you think about a city, cities are much harder than the surrounding natural environment. And it's because they've got lots of these impervious surfaces, these things that, you know, don't have trees, don't have grass, don't have plants. And so when I see a parking lot going in, my first thought is mine, like, what are urban planners going to do to combat all that extra added heat in our environment? And one of the women that I write about in my book, which is all about urban ecology, she actually works with a lot of city planners to understand how we can plant trees and grow our canopy cover too. You know, when we have to put in a parking lot because we need that space, you know, where can we balance that out by adding trees and greenery in creative ways?
Okay, so I'm glad you brought up your book. So congratulations, you are a published author. I love the title, Chasing Bats and Tracking Rats. So I'll let everyone know that it's out in November. You can pre-order it. It's published by Annick Press, all very, very exciting. Tell me how this came to be.
Yeah, so this was like, I feel very fortunate. I'm going to preface this by saying, because I feel like a lot of people struggle to get into writing kids' books. And I was like given this opportunity to pitch. So I'm friends with Jesse Hildebrand, he and I did our undergrads together. For any of your viewers, if you've ever been in Exploring by the Seat of Your Pants session, that's all Jesse, he's amazing. And, you know, he and I worked together on a couple events. He kind of knows that I like to tell stories about science, and I'm really invested in communicating about science and how the process of how we do science. And so he was talking with some folks at Annick, and they indicated that, you know, we want people to write kids nonfiction books, but we want scientists who are excited about writing about science for kids. And so he connected me with an editor, and I pitched a couple ideas to her, and the rest is kind of history. They were really interested in my work. So I study bats, and I was focused on, at the time, studying bats that lived in Toronto's Hyde Park. And so they were really interested in that work. And as we talked about me writing a book just about bats and me studying bats in cities, it became very clear that like there was so much here in this realm of urban ecology, so many other cool scientists tackling questions in city landscapes that kids could really get excited about. And so we decided to really dive in, and I pitched this idea around urban ecology as a whole.
And I had the chance to go online and get a sneak peek at your book and see all the chapters. And there's a lot of great thought-provoking questions. Like the chapters, I love the way they're laid out. And there's a couple that really stuck out for me. One of them is, why are greener cities better for humans? Can you answer that a little bit?
Yeah. So, I mean, I think I kind of alluded to it or kind of hinted at it earlier. Greener cities make space for wildlife, right? And where there's wildlife, where there are plants, where there are insects, all of that, those species work together to create a healthy functioning ecosystem. And we as humans, whether it be in a city or outside a city, we get a lot of benefits from those ecosystems. They provide us humans with these ecosystem services, right? So if you think about walking through a park or walking down a street that's covered in greenery, that makes us feel good, right? There's a lot of research to show that nature just makes us happier, but it also physically makes us healthier, right? If you think about trees and plants, they release oxygen through the process of photosynthesis. So they're providing us with oxygen. Their roots hold together the soil. Their roots also provide, or their branches, I should say, of these trees also provide homes for lots of other organisms that we depend on, things like birds who maybe are key pollinators in some parts of the world, but also insects who are really important pollinators. So it's all kind of connected, and it's all part of, we need that around to keep us healthy, but also to keep our planet as a whole healthy.
Now, you also talk about that you use some wacky but awesome tools to gather data as an urban ecologist. Like I read ratmobile and bug vacuum. You got to tell me a little bit more about those.
Yeah. So one of the really big things that I was hoping to accomplish with this book is not just, you know, show kids kind of the end parts of knowledge. So like, here's what we know about nature and city. I also wanted to take them through this process of how, as a scientist, I and some of the other scientists I read in the book, like how we actually learn what we learn. And so in each chapter, there are these like sections where we talk about like a key tool that a scientist uses in their work. So one of the scientists, her name is Dr. Kaylee Byers. She's based out of Vancouver and she studies urban rats. And, you know, Kaylee's problem was like, okay, I have all these rats and I want to study their movement in the city, but like catching all of those rats and then bringing them back to my lab at the university, that's really, really stressful for the rats. I don't want to do that to them. It's stressful for me as a person. And so instead, what she did is she actually developed a mobile lab in this big white panel van that she calls the Ratmobile. And so she drives around the streets of Vancouver, catching rats, collecting all of the data that she needs on site in her very awesome Ratmobile. And then Charlotte DeKaiser, actually now Dr. Charlotte DeKaiser, she recently defended her PhD. She studies pollinators. And so she needed a quick and easy way to, you know, sample bees that were visiting these really large flowering trees. And sampling them so that she could let them go. And so she's got a tiny little vacuum that she'll use to suck up the bees into a little test tube. She'll take a look at them and then let them go when she's identified them.
That's so awesome. That's so great. But you've also said that gathering this data or that science can sometimes be messy. What do you mean by that?
Yeah, it rarely goes as planned. And so I think one of the central themes to the book, each chapter starts with a story from the field to kind of help kids and help readers, should say kids of all ages, really understand what we as scientists go through, some of everything. So I share my most like dangerous night in the field. Kaylee talks about the first rat that she ever caught and how tricky he was to get a handle on. And then it transitions to, you know, this is why we were in the situation we were, this is the question that we were asking, and these are our hypotheses when we studied, when we were starting out with this project. And I think one of the things that kind of unites all the scientists in the book is the conclusions that we draw at the end of our project are often in contrast or the exact opposite of what we thought when we started. And so I think that was, for me, was something I really wanted to show to readers, that, you know, we have hypotheses, they're based off of data, we think that they're going to be kind of correct, but sometimes, you know, the wildlife we work with don't cooperate, or we find a new and completely different and exciting pattern, and that's a totally normal part of science, right? It doesn't always go the way that we think, but I think part of being a scientist is being creative and recognizing where you can pivot and say, okay, it didn't work and I'm sad, but like, hey, here's this other super cool thing that we learned and said, and this is why it's just as valuable and it's important.
Who did you dedicate your book to?
Oh, that's a great one. So if you don't mind, I'm actually going to grab my book.
I do not mind at all. Now that you have it in your hand, how did you feel when that got delivered to your house?
Oh my gosh, it was like the most exciting moment ever to finally really. So it's this is not the final version. This is the advanced reader's copy. So I think I'll be even more excited when the final hardcover version. But it was just like so exciting. But to be honest, I couldn't be that excited for that long because my mom was here and she very promptly took it to read it in full with my dad. So
I can totally appreciate that.
Yeah, so I actually dedicated the book to my parents. And so the dedication is to my parents, who helped a Black city kid grow up with a deep love of nature. I hope this book helps other melanated kids to do the same. And that kind of just goes back to my parents are really, have been my biggest supporters, and they've really encouraged me and my brothers. I have two brothers, they're both engineers. They both also pursued graduate degrees, and that's not something that anyone in our family had ever done before. And I really just like chalk that up to my parents being like ride or die for us. They have always been there, always supported us, always encouraging us, and really just pushing us to see more in ourselves.
Yeah, that's so beautiful. I bet your mom and dad are going to frame that.
I hope so.
Yeah, no, that's wonderful. Congratulations. I told you pre-ordered the book, and I can't wait for me to get my copy. That's so great. The other thing, Cylita, is that you're really interested in bats. Like you're all, and bats have been in the media, of course, with COVID and the pandemic.
Yep.
You probably were into them way before all of that. Why do you find them so interesting?
It's weird. I can't explain it. I feel like, so I didn't intend off to starting to study bats. So when I was deciding like, okay, I finished my undergrad, I think I want to go to grad school, I think I want to do a PhD. At the time I had been working in a lab that focused on studying these very cute, adorable primates or monkeys that live in trees in South America. They're super tiny, super cute, like the kind of mammal that everyone wants to study. And then I applied to grad school and I was like, well, you know, I was kind of looking around, I was like, do I want to work with fish? And I decided I wanted to work in a particular problem space where humans and people were coming into conflict. We see that conflict happen in urban environments, but as you've kind of highlighted in the media with bats, we also see that conflict when wildlife sometimes share diseases with humans. And so I decided I wanted to work in the space. And as I was figuring out what kind of questions I wanted to ask, I was actually contacted by a professor who had seen my resume, seen my CV, and he said, hey, you've got a lot of experience working with animals and small mammals and large mammals. Like, you know, I'm looking for students and I study bats. And that's actually was kind of my gateway. So this other person reaching out being like, this is my research program. And, you know, we talked, I did some reading and I was just like, wow, this group is just so cool. And I think that's what I find with a lot of bat biologists. It's like once you learn a little bit about them, you just keep getting sucked in.
You get right.
and then that's it. It's part because they're very misunderstood creatures, right? There are lots of myths and misconceptions that surround them, but they are so amazing, right? They're the only mammals. So they're like you and I, mammals, warm-blooded, fuzzy things. They give birth to live babies, but they can fly, and no other mammal can do that. They also live a very long time for their size. They're also the second most species rich group of mammals. There are over 1400 different types around the world.
Wow.
They live everywhere except the high Arctic and the Antarctic. And they're just, they're so magical when you start to look at some of their faces and like study the way that they live. And I think what blows my mind is, you know, of those over 1400 different species, there are only a handful that we know a lot about. So there's still so much that we don't know about this group, but this group is incredibly important for the functioning of our ecosystems. And, you know, some bats feed on nectar and they're pollinators, some feed on insects and they act as free pest control for our crops. So they do important things. We need to have them around, and to help keep them around, we need to understand more about this group.
They do have cute faces. I have to agree.
Adorable faces.
Their faces are pretty cute. I'll give you that one. Now, you touched, you said something that's true. There's a lot of myths and misconceptions about bats. So I'm going to ask you, as a bat expert, is the expression blind as a bat true?
It is not. So that expression comes, I think, from the fact that lots of species of bats echolocate. They use these high frequency sound waves outside the range of human hearing to navigate their nighttime environments. But just because they're using this sound or this sonar to help them, you know, say, quote unquote, see,
right,
they still have eyes. Those eyes still work. But for some species, you know, not that well, but like they can still see stuff. But then there's an entire group of bats, our pteropodids, also known as the flying foxes. They've actually, they don't have the ability to echolocate, and instead they get around in the dark using their vision, and they can see their nighttime vision far better than any human. So that phrase, blind as a bat, is not true and it's not fair.
It's not fair. Now, growing up, I was always told that bats would get caught in my hair. And as a kid, you know, some adults kind of put their fears on kids sometimes. It was like, oh, there's bats nearby. Be careful, it'll get caught in your hair. Is that true?
I mean, so it's interesting. My field partner, every time someone asked us this question, we were working in the field, she was like, well, I mean, look at me, see any bats? And she's like, if that were true, my hair would be like big as a beehive, because
right.
So I think, again, that comes, bats will fly very close to us. But they have, again, around, you know, in Southeastern Ontario, all of our species are echolocators. They know where they're going, right? Like, they may zip past you, but it may be because you've got insects kind of gathering around your body and they're going in for a tasty snack. They're not going to hit you and get stuck in your hair. Now, on occasion, you might have a juvenile bat who's trying to do a little bit of a tricky maneuver that's kind of perhaps outside of their abilities. And so, yeah, they can collide with objects. They can, you know, hit you. And I can see there being a time, you know, at one point in which one bat kind of flew off and got stuck in someone's hair. And then from thenceforth, right, it was like, all bats can get stuck in your hair. But
yeah,
no,
it's not a common thing.
No,
it's not common. Okay.
I've never once had that happen.
How about, they're often related with vampires. Do they like to suck blood like vampires?
Yeah, that's another great, great question. So there are three species that all live in South America that are what we call hematophagous. They feed entirely on blood. So our quote, vampire bats, but they don't actually suck blood. Instead, what they do is they will fly over to prey while it's sleeping, and they tend to feed on wild mammals, wild birds, but also livestock. And occasionally they have bitten humans if they get trapped in a room with them and can't leave to feed somewhere else. But they don't like bite and latch on and suck blood. Instead, what they do is they make a tiny little cut. The blood will pool in that cut, and then they'll lick up that blood, kind of like a cat licks up milk.
I see.
Kind of adorable, but in a semi-disgusting way.
Kind of adorable. Now, I've heard you say bats have superpowers. What would you say is the greatest superpower they have?
Yeah, I think I've got to go back to flight. Flight is pretty darn amazing. And it's only ever evolved four times, like in the history of like life on Earth.
Yeah.
Insects do it, bats do it, birds do it, and the fourth group of pterosaurs, the now extinct group of flying reptiles. So if I could have any superpower, I think it would be that one.
Right. Now, do you have a superpower? That's what I'm going to ask you next. What's your superpower?
Do I have a superpower? Oh, that's a tough one. I think my superpower, and this may sound a little corny, is not letting myself be limited by what other people say, you know, a scientist should be like, or how they should act like, right? Like, I went to grad school and I was really interested in being a scientist, but I also did a lot of things that other people told me I shouldn't do as a scientist. I spent time talking to kids. I spent time working on, like, you know, writing this kid's book. I want to keep writing about science for people, but then I also want to go and work in tech and build really complicated engineering systems. And so I kind of pivoted and I tried something different. But at many points in my career, I haven't limited myself to doing things the way that other people felt I should. And I think that's something I've really benefited from.
Well, Cylita, I would say one of your superpowers is actually taking a topic like urban ecology and making it something that even kids and adults can relate to. Like, you're a very good storyteller, and that takes talent. So I would say that's one of your superpowers too.
Thank you.
Yeah, this has been so great. I should thank Jesse Hildebrand too. I interviewed him a few episodes ago, and he is, like you said, a fantastic person to know. It's nice to have him in your corner. So I'm glad he got you connected with the publisher, and I wish you nothing but success with your new book. I'm very excited. Thank you. I know you're busy. Thank you for taking the time to chat with us today.
Well, thank you for wanting to take the time, and I'm really looking forward to hearing your thoughts on my book when you get it on November 9th.
Absolutely. Thanks so much. Take care. Bye.